And good day, YouTube, and welcome to another episode of Beer Dweebs United. Tonight we're going to be looking at women in brewing. We have three fine examples of women in brewing in all different aspects of the beer industry. And we have myself and my two great cohorts here who are just going to be here to look pretty ourselves. And yeah, we will do this. Comments might not still work on YouTube. They sometimes do. They sometimes don't. Since Google Plus did its reverse break, we'll try and make it work. You can leave comments on the Facebook site. You can email me. You can do whatever you want. We'll try and get things worked out. Yeah. And I guess we will go like this. We will introduce the ladies. We will introduce, you know, ourselves. You don't need our introduction. So starting with Robin, I guess.
Hi there. My name is Robin LeBlanc. I do a lot of things, but I write for my own site. It's called The Thirsty Wench, www.thethirstywench.com. I'm the beer columnist for Torontoist, a local news site here in Toronto. And also, currently, I'm co-authoring with the other beer writer, Jordan St. John, on the Ontario Craft Beer Guide, which is due to be published in spring of 2016 from Dundurn Press.
Alrighty, and Erin, introduce yourself if you would.
I am Erin Broadfoot. I do a whole bunch of things right now. Some of the main things I'm doing, of course, I'm a brewer at the Five Paddles, which is a microbrewery in Whitby, Ontario. I co-run a group out here in Durham that was inspired by the Society of Beer Drinking Ladies and a few other women's groups that kind of brings the women out here in Durham together. And we meet every couple of months and do a variety of beer-related things. And I'm also a BJCP judge and kind of the self-designated director of BJCP exams out here in Durham. And I've run a few, and I'm setting a few more up, and that about sums it up.
Awesome. And last but not least is Erica.
Hi, guys. My name is Erica Campbell, and I work at the lovely Black Oak Brewing Company in Etobicoke. Ken started that about 16 years ago, so I do a host of things, a lot of sales, marketing, events, logistics, a lot of social media. It's great, and I also co-run with four other lovely ladies the Society of Beer Drinking Ladies in Toronto. We do monthly bevies. We get about 175, 180, whatever, women out. And we serve all local craft beer in pop-up locations around Toronto. So the next one is in 2 nights. We're at Bevy number 22. So it's going well.
Yeah, that's great. And what are we all drinking tonight? I guess we'll do reverse order. Erica, what are you drinking?
Right now I've got the classic Black Oak Pale Ale in my SOBDL glass, trying to rep simultaneously both things at the same time.
Alrighty. Yeah. Erin?
I'm sipping on water right now, but I have a long, dark voyage for a little bit later on tonight.
Nice. Alrighty.
Long, dark Robin. Voyage to what, Erin?
Oh, you know where.
Oh, and I'm drinking water because I need a break from drinking all of the beers in Ontario.
That's nothing. Maybe it's something in, you know, like a month span, but
yeah.
Lee, what are you drinking tonight?
I am drinking a Boxing Rock Crafty Jack.
Nice.
Nicholas?
I'm going to be drinking a Fiederois North Shore Regiment barley wine.
Oh, we talked about that last week, I believe it was.
Yep. I bought like 3 bottles of it, so.
And I got the Black Oat Nut Brown. Yeehaw.
Yay.
And to start the night off, just to get to know you three more, we're going to do a quick the quick 10 questions that we ask everybody whenever we do that I ask everybody whenever I do a brewery segment. So I guess we'll answer in the order of Robin, Erin, Erica, just because then I don't have to ask it 3 times. And yeah, first and foremost, what got you into the industry?
Well, really, I just started writing. And just the more I started writing about it, the more the doors sort of, I guess, opened for me and allowed me to sort of get a good look at the industry. So I think I started my site in around 2011. And that was just sort of going through my journey of, you know, just learning about craft beer. So yeah, just the more I wrote, the more I got to meet people within the industry, and then the more I sort of became, in a sense, a part of it. So.
Awesome.
Okay. I had a friend, a good friend, who was a professional brewer and came over with a few of his professional wares and a few of his homebrewed wares, and they were really good, which inspired me and a few of my friends to try brewing at home. So I dug my dad's old dusty homebrew kit out of his basement and attempted to make a beer and kind of got my first beer out of it and kind of went down the rabbit hole, and I've been completely addicted ever since. So it's just been one thing after the other, but that's where it started.
Alrighty, and lastly, Erica.
I actually started in the industry via a Kijiji ad, working the Toronto Festival of Beer with Great Lakes Brewery. So that's where I started. I was there for about a year and a half doing part-time kind of just spontaneous events and LCBO tastings and whatnot, and got a great opportunity to work at Black Oak. So I jumped ship, or I jumped the Gardner Expressway, quite literally. But yeah, it was quite like happenstance, which, you know, my story is not unique. It's definitely kind of a funny, quirky part of this industry, is most people have really interesting different paths, and we're all just kind of together in this brewing industry, I find, a lot of us.
I'm so glad that you ended up saying it was for the Toronto Festival of Beer, because I was going to make fun of Ken being even cheaper than usual.
Yeah.
Favorite part of the industry, and again, we'll go Robin down the line.
Favorite part of the industry, God. Favorite part of the industry, geez. I definitely have to say just all of the colorful characters you end up meeting. there's just a lot of like crazy characters. I think everyone, at least on the Ontario side of things, has a Sam and Spinny story, or definitely a Sam story from Sawdust. Just you meet a lot of really interesting people from all sort of different walks of life. The more you sort of like meet brewers as well, the more you sort of like get a feel that these are like really artistic people. So I'd have to just say all the crazy characters that, you know, make up this awesome community.
Alrighty.
My favorite part is definitely the creativity. It's that being able to blend the art that is making beer with the science of it. So it's taking those two passions and putting them together to make something that you love. And the people. There's so many amazing, awesome people in this industry, and I've made some incredible friends along the way. So it's lots of fun.
And Erica.
Cool, yeah. Just to feed off those 2 points, totally the same. Like, just the community aspect's really cool. And also just, we're in such a time in the industry, you know. There's so many breweries popping up, and there's so much innovation, and the beer's getting better and better, and it's just an exciting time to be part of the Ontario scene, so.
Alrighty, least favorite part of the scene, of the industry.
I guess one of the things that we're probably going to touch on here, some of the sexism. I think some of that would definitely be up there. Just the really shitty jokes that aren't funny. The backhanded comments and a lot of the crap in marketing. So yeah, the sexism.
Alrighty.
I obviously would have to agree. There's definitely some of those misogynistic tendencies that happen. But other than that, I think my least favorite is the burns and the injuries. I am a massive klutz, so putting me around boiling and buckets and trough drains is usually a disaster. But it's fun and leads to many a good story.
Alrighty, and Erica.
I can't say the Burns because I don't brew, but definitely for me personally, it's the work-life balance. I find I'm it's such a busy, busy job, and obviously the SOBDL is a massive component. I'm not complaining. It's really fun, but just finding that time to relax and do non-beer-related things, I think, is something that I struggle with in a good way.
Alrighty, favorite style of beer?
Favorite style? You know what? I gotta say I love a really good Pilsner. Yeah, the Pilsner sort of has been the thing for me. For some reason, I can't help myself. I always end up, my go-to beer ends up being a Pilsner or Cal.
That's pretty cool. Sweet. You don't hear Pilsner as somebody's top choice.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just one of the type of beer that I really like is just the simple done well. The ones where I don't have to think about it too much if I don't want to. But if I do think about it, I think good things, you know? Something that I can, like, genuinely wind down with because as a beer writer and I think as a critic that, you know, you guys would definitely know as well, it's hard to find a good relaxation, like, personal time beer because the mind is sort of always spinning away when you try it. So finding something that you can just sort of relax to has always sort of been my struggle, and I'm able to find a couple of beers, thankfully. So,
nice.
Mm-hmm. For me, it's stouts. I'm a stout girl. I love the dark beers, especially imperial stouts. I try not to drink too many, but those are my favorites, definitely.
It might just be because I have absolutely no pigment, but stouts are my thing, too.
Yeah, they're the best.
Might be the Irish, actually.
Alrighty, and Erica.
Yeah, I'm going to kind of go with Erin on that one. I'm not a big hophead. I really like porters and stouts. I mean, I love chocolate and I love coffee, so it's kind of a natural combination. And I like sessionable ales, so I'm really a fan of under 6% porter stouts and kind of that nut brown vibe.
Alrighty, and least favorite style?
Least favorite style? That's a tough one. I almost don't feel like I have one. It's just, I guess, barley wine, you know? sorry, Nick. Sorry. I'm sure that one is fantastic.
I haven't drank it.
Okay. but yeah, if I had to make a pick, probably that.
That's fair.
I guess I'm standard American lager. I mean, I can appreciate a well-done one, but probably not what I'm going to pick to drink on my average night.
See? Just like me, too. I'd say a Pilsner, lager, and I'd say a stout for my favorite.
I see. Good taste.
You guys should drink together more often. I would have to say a black IPA. I'm not a big fan. I think it just messes with all the things I love about dark beers. It just really gives a big hop character, and it just kind of, it's not for me. So, black IPAs.
Okay, now this next question would normally be, you have three beers for the rest of your life, one from your brewery, one from another craft brewery, and one from the big guys. For Robin, we'll let her do one from Ontario, one from Canada, one from the big guys. But for the other two, you have to pick one from your brewery and one from another craft brewery.
So, sorry, one from Ontario, one from Canada, and one from the big guys?
Yeah. Or, you know what, the second one can be from anywhere, as long as it's craft.
Okay, as long as it's craft. Okay. Well, I think for Ontario, it's going to be Sawdust City Little Norway Pale Lager. I was in London, Ontario a couple of months ago for the Four City Beer Festival. And like anyone who goes to London, I went to Milosh's. And I was just drinking there, and frankly, I could drink that beer all day long. Really good.
I actually did a shower review with that beer, and it was a great shower beer.
Yeah?
Exactly what you want. First off, it was canned, and it was just something you could just drink forever with nothing. It was just so simple and just go.
Yeah, and it does exactly what it says on the tin, and it's I enjoy that. Okay, second. As long as it's craft. All, it doesn't help when you said, like, oh, just the entire world, whatever, just pick one.
Remember, you don't get to drink anything but these three.
Yeah, I know. That's definitely on my mind. As long as it's craft, as long as it's in the world. Oh, man. I didn't think this would be so hard. I don't know why it's so hard right now. I think it's probably because I'm on the spot.
It's a lifeline.
Yeah. You know what? I'm just gonna. Damn it! I didn't think it would be this hard. I'm so sorry. I'm bringing everything down here.
Don't worry. There won't be a quiz later or anything like that.
Okay. I'm gonna say Stone IPA.
Okay.
Stone IPA. It's a very respectable IPA. I really enjoy it. Actually, no. Arrogant Bastard. Yes, Arrogant Bastard. That's a good one.
Writing in from a big guy.
Okay, and from the big guy. So I guess I would be able to include Goose Island in that?
Yeah, they're a big guy now.
Yeah, so definitely when I was in Chicago not too long ago, and they had Proprietor's Bourbon County Stout, which... Oh, just incredibly smooth, chocolatey, with hints of, like, real good coconut in there. It was just a nice roasted... Oh, it was easily one of my best, one of my favorite beers. So
that's one of the few of the variants I haven't had yet, and mostly because apparently you have to, like, murder 5 people to get a bottle of it.
It's actually gone up. You have to murder 6 people to get that now.
Ah.
6 people, and you need to sacrifice your... a couple of drops of blood to, I forget the name of the god, but he's up there. And whole altar, it's kind of weird, but it's worth it. So.
Yeah, and if I wasn't a 300-pound albino that would easily be picked out of a lineup, maybe.
Maybe.
Kind of hard to admit.
Well, Erin. If they ever release in the North Pole, you might be able to blend in.
Yeah. Your brewery, another craft brewery, big guy.
Okay. My brewery, a little shameless self-promotion, be In Your Face, which, of course, is one of my babies. Another brewery, probably right now Bolshevik Bastard, maybe Kentucky Bastard. Love that frickin' beer. And big guy, probably also go with Goose Island, but say Sophie.
Sophie's good.
And I love Sophie.
Sophie goes really well, I find, with a lot of things, but with seafood I'm finding especially, like scallops, or if you got any lobster, that works too.
Nice.
Yeah. We all have lobster, yeah.
We just all have lobster kicking around in our kitchen.
Erica.
Okay, my beer, it's fresh on my mind because it's our current seasonal, Nutcracker Porter. It's just so good. Mm. And I have heard it was one of the first kind of seasonals in Ontario, so it has this nice little backstory to it. Ken brought it out in, like, I think 2000 or something crazy. Another brewery, I just spent a weekend out at Church Key with John Graham, so great guy, great beers, and I love Holy Smoke. It's such a good beer. So I really like smoked kind of peaty Rausch beers. And then from a big guy, I think my first beer was, or my first kind of gateway beer in at Laurier at the student pub in fourth year university was Pitchers of Rickard's White. So like totally terrible, silly, Molson product with orange slices in it, but there's just something nostalgic about that beer that brings me back to, you know, youth and being silly and drunk in Waterloo, Ontario, that I'll always go back to Rickard's White.
Well, if you want a tiny bit of indie cred as well, you could just say Blue Moon then.
A different hop strain. They taste the exact same, but it's a different hop strain.
Yeah, you
could do a lot worse than Rickard's White, though, honestly.
You could. Like, my first beer was Old Vienna. I don't know, because I was 8 at the time. I don't know if it was an O'Keefe product or a Molson product, because that's the same year that sale happened. But that was my first one. I still reminisce about it.
Definitely had beer before. Let me just disclaim that. But my first, like, oh my gosh, I kind of like beer, and not just getting drunk on wine, was Rickard's White.
Yeah, see, my wife swears that every beer tastes the same, and that's why we make her drink all the horrible things we end up finding here, just to make her realize that they don't taste the same. But she used to go to the college pub too, and she'd only buy beer because it was like dollar beer night. So she'd buy a dollar beer and a $5 drink and chase the beer with the drink, and that's what she would do back then. What would you guys be doing if you weren't doing something in this industry?
Well, I often had these fantasies of just sort of, like, living up in the Yukon, changing my name to, like, Francine Dubois. being a fry cook in the Yukon and just sort of, like, solving mysteries. I'm going to go with that.
That's ridiculous and amazing.
It's amazing.
Franny, not Francine. Franny. Well, Francine would be the official name, but Franny Dubois, fry cook/detective. So.
Alrighty.
Yeah.
Sounds like a spin-off show from Northern Exposure or something like that.
You know what? I think I was watching an episode of Northern Exposure when I came up with that life plan. So. Yeah.
There you go.
Perfect. Okay. It's funny because right before I got into craft beer, I swore I would never go into beer professionally because I knew it wasn't the easiest career. And I was in medicine before this. So the guys kind of talked me into coming into the brewery and going professional. I was actually about to go back to school to finish another degree in women's studies and gender studies. I was going to finish that off, and then I was hoping to go into midwifery. So if not beer, I'd probably be catching babies. And I actually still teach prenatal classes on some weekends to stay connected to that side.
It's actually really awesome how many brewers actually come from sort of medical fields, like medical backgrounds, which I think is really awesome.
It's the science, right? It's used to the medical science bit, but you get to actually bring some art in, which is nice.
Yeah, no, it's a really cool, it's a really awesome balance like that.
And if my wife wasn't probably spying on me right now, I'd tell you a story about catching a baby, but I'll be in trouble. So.
Oh, God.
Erica, you're up.
Yeah. Similar to Erin, I came from an education, well, similar in the sense that I'd probably be doing what I was doing before I got into beer, which was teaching. So I'm trained as a JK to 6 teacher. I'd probably be in the field of education to some degree. I mean, I get to satisfy quite a bit in the craft beer industry, which is fun, in a different way, teaching about beer. I'd probably be teaching children or something. I don't know. It feels weird to say that.
You can borrow mine if you like.
Okay. And I'd be a midwife. Yay!
And I'd just solve murders in the Yukon and then we'll care.
This is you, and we would get drunk in the Yukon.
Alrighty, so the only other question that would be out there, unless the two of you are home brewers, the last one on that little list of stupid questions we ask is, what's the weirdest thing you've ever brewed with? So unless either of you ever home brewed, I guess it's just Erin, and then we'll get into what tonight was really about.
I have home brewed, but there's nothing really sort of been weird. I mean, I guess I made sort of an American brown ale with chamomile. And that was it, so, cool. Yeah, that was it, so, the rest has essentially just been, like, ciders where I, you know, just throw in cherries and stuff like that. So, I mean, nothing out of the ordinary.
Alrighty. And yourself, Erin?
When I first started into brewing, I was convinced I would be able to make, because I worked with herbal medicine in the past, I was convinced I'd be able to make good beer with a lot of the herbs I used to work with, which was not true. Most of those herbs tasted terrible and made terrible beer. But there was one beer that came out pretty good, I think. I brewed with the Five Paddles for Beer for Boobs, and it was done with galactagog herbs.
So, oh, that beer sucked. it was pretty good.
It got an interesting reception because nobody knew what a galactagog was. Everybody just knew it was a beer with a woman who had three breasts on the front, and it was terrible, and everybody pretty much missed the joke because it was beer for boobs, but when you put it into a brewery, people, it was well received, though. So that's what's important.
Then, Erica, have you ever homebrewed or anything?
No, I'm not really super interested in that part, but we brewed recently at Great Lakes of Blackie on the pilot Great Lakes system with the SOBDL. We brewed a beet American pale ale. We used beets, kind of cool. We had to shred up a boatload of beets. And Jen is one of our co-founders of the SBDL, and she's a really awesome home brewer. So it was her recipe, and we had it at Cast Days, and we just showcased it at the People's Pint. So
you were channeling your inner Belgian?
You what?
You were channeling your inner Belgian there?
Pretty much. Yeah, it was good. It was tasty.
Alrighty. So, before we get on into anything, first, Greg said that comments are disabled on both Google and YouTube, but he did post that on Google, so whatever. Anything either of you want to say before we get into questions with the girls, or any questions you want to ask them?
Okay, I actually managed to write two down. I managed to actually think of something, so. And I don't know, these might end up covering stuff that we already had. Question-wise, but I'll just throw it out here anyway. Actually, I know one of them will probably come up later, so I'll just leave this one aside. But I guess the one I have here is, what do you guys think of the term chick beer? Do you think there's any validity to the term at all in terms of what generally female drinkers seem to gravitate towards? Or is the idea that women only liking lagers, fruit beers, wheat beers, is it more of a broadly incorrect stereotype? And maybe has that changed more in recent years now that there's actually more selection and more women seem to be getting into beer as a whole? I don't know, did that question make sense at all?
It did. If no one's jumping up, I'll jump up. I think we all think it's a ridiculous term. I know leading a group where I drink with women on a regular basis, the beer I find is the gateway for most of the females I seem to drink with in that group is mild stouts, which is by no means what most people seem to call a chick beer. The term chick in itself is a terrible term, and yeah, so obviously I think there's absolutely no validity, and you look at it, beer hasn't been, and the chick beers, these apparent chick beers, Coors Light, Budweiser, all these beers that are supposed to be the girls' beers, they're marketed using bikini-clad, scantily-clad women, which completely goes against the idea that these are chick beers, because they're being marketed to men anyhow. I'm sure everybody else has opinions on this, too.
Yeah, and, it's always pissed me off when people make designations like that, because holy shit, this might come as a shock to a lot of people, but I mean, women make 50% of the earth, in terms of humans, and as human beings, we have varied interests. I mean, of course, it's not going to be the same. Varied interests based on our experiences, just our general likes and all that stuff, so yeah, absolute bullshit that we have this natural tendency towards, I guess when I've heard the term chick beer used, it's mainly been used in reference to like incredibly light beers or very fruity sweet drinks, which frankly I've seen men enjoy just as much, and I've enjoyed some of the more robust. I know a lot of other women that enjoy it. I mean, it's I don't get why it has to be split up like that. I think it's very outdated. I think it's very ass backwards dumb. So, yeah.
Totally. And I think that's why the craft industry is exciting, is because, sure, there's definitely things here and there, like weird female misogyny stuff going on still with labeling and branding in Ontario, but for the most part, it's pretty solid. And, I mean, that maybe is a testament to the amount of women that are starting to work in the industry that are actually raising a stink and being like, this isn't cool. Like, you can't have labels like this. And, you know, I'm seeing it at the bevies. We're getting, like, women in their 60s that are like, finally, yes, I can come and drink in, like, this women atmosphere with my daughters. I've always liked real British ale or real American IPAs. I'm just, you know, and women, and I do LCBO tastings, or when you do events, the amount of women that are just, like, totally down with drinking beer is pretty high, and they're open to experimenting and trying new stuff. So it's exciting. I don't know. I think it's cool. It's a pretty untapped, to make a bad beer pun, thing that still needs to be explored further. So,
thank you.
Mm-hmm. Now, on the idea of numbers of females in brewing, I mean, we have seen it on a rise. What do you think is added to that rise? How do you think it's going to go in the future? Do you think we're going to get closer to a 50-50 mix? I don't know.
I mean, I seriously hope so. I mean, there's definitely a rise in terms of what is added to that rise. I think it's just, it's 2015, you know, where, not meaning to quote Justin Trudeau on that, but I mean, like, where it's 2015, you know, again, going into this sort of, like, consciousness of, like, hey, women are human beings, which are capable of complex thoughts, complex interests. You know, we have all these varied interests, and of course, you know, why wouldn't anyone get into a field that interests them? So I think you're just finding genuine interest and less pushback than I would say since like you know, of course, like the 90s or even the early aughts, even the late aughts for that matter. Of people of women entering that field. So,
and I think also on the flip side, you know, women are more attracted to applying for jobs in the Ontario craft beer industry because it just feels better. It feels more welcoming. Like a lot of it's if you know Black Oak. Sure, I am one of the only females at Black Oak, and I was one of not a lot of females at Great Lakes. But you know, it is still. It's a very inclusive, for the most part, environment, and I feel totally equitable in my day-to-day interactions at the breweries. So, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think, and I totally agree with that. I mean, I'm going to lose sight of the first, but on that point, within the brewery itself, most of the issues I find are where you feel your gender isn't necessarily from your colleagues or from people you work with in the industry. It's from outside the industry. I find it's usually if there's reactions that people are surprised I brew or surprised I work in beer. It's not the men I meet out in the field. It's people coming into the brewery. Mm-hmm. For the most part, interactions between colleagues in the industry is always great. Certainly where I work, everything is great. I've never had problems there. But when it comes to females in the industry, I think when I started, like in Toronto, you could count kind of in one hand how many women were working production lines and brewing. Maybe more than one hand. But still, it was a fairly small number. And now I feel like every time a brewery opens or everywhere you look, it's, you know, it's a woman brewer or a woman working the production line. So it's definitely changing, and there's definitely more women coming in, I think, to the production side for sure.
Well, I'm actually, from an outsider's perspective, I guess, well, the writer's perspective anyways, you know, I totally agree what Erin was saying, you know, that a lot of it is just sort of outside, but then again, there's still a lot of work to be done on the inside as well. And even, I've been learning a lot of that in terms of writing the book, the Ontario Craft Beer Guide book, where I would explain my credentials, I would explain what the project is, I would talk to the brewer, and several brewers, as in, like, well more than one, would almost feel like the need to sort of quiz me on my credentials. I think a couple even asked like if I actually even drink beer. It's something that can be taken as like not the way, like, not in the sexist way, but also it's one of those, I can't help but sort of consider that if I was a male writer coming into that situation, my credentials wouldn't be in question so much.
Mm. So yeah, I have had within the industry some issues too, not necessarily with my direct colleagues, but I can see where you'd probably be coming from.
Yeah, I mean, it's still a problem, but I mean, like, if I explain that I'm, I know how to make a brown, I know what makes a brown ale brown, for instance, or, you know, surprisingly, in the 4 years that I, 4 or 5 years I've done this, yeah, I have had a few beers, you know, and thus I would write a book about it, so.
Yeah, I agree. I think the where I experience it the most is at the event, kind of talking to customers or sometimes working with bars. You know, some bar owners are just not the best human beings, and you know, so that's where being a woman out in the field being a sales rep can be a little bit challenging. For the most part, you know, you can be tough and harass them for money when they owe, you know, your brewery money and all, play the game, you know, but I do question, you know, if I was a guy, how would this be different? But I mean, and you know, you do get that thing, if you ever are pouring at an event in the summer or whatever, there is that, like, oh, so are you just kind of you work at an agency, you're an events girl, and it's like, no, I work at this brewery, and I know my shit, and, like, if you wanna get into it, let's get into it, you know? So there is always, I think, when you see a woman behind a booth pouring beer for a man, there is that kind of general understanding that they're subservient, they're gonna serve the man, they're gonna serve a guy, and they don't know much about beer.
Well, and, yeah, no, definitely when it comes to events as well. I mean, in the 5 years I've been doing this, and I've been keeping track, there's not a single beer event I've gone to where I wasn't either propositioned by, you know, by this, like, disgusting dude. The bar would assume that I'm there with my boyfriend. The guy would quiz me on beer elements, and, like, every single event, and I'm not talking about, like, stuff like, you know, what the hell, stuff like T-Fob, where you kind of expect that type of demographic, but other, you know, more higher ones as well, so.
Well, I was going to ask if you think that maybe, like, Toronto Festival of Beer does add to that idea, too, because you go in, and even when I've been there, there's lots of times where you see the girl that obviously hasn't really worked at the brewery behind the table, and you ask her a question, even like, what's the ABV? Oh, I don't know. And I think that that actually does help add to that stereotype that goes out there.
Yeah, T-Fob's tricky. T-Fob's really tricky. Like, you know, back in the day, that was the only festival that was around, so Ken always did it, and, you know, Great Lakes always did it, and all the older breweries, Wellington and Nickelbrook and whatever, you know, everybody, that was the one big epic festival, and now it's really changed into a very different thing. But Jen Murphy and Ingrid Kim, they're two of the main organizers that work at Beerilicious, and they're amazing people, and they, you know, they do understand that it is kind of a bit of a bros club, and it is a bit of a, or quite a kind of a drunk boys club. So, you know, they're trying, and I mean, it's almost like there's two separate T-Fobs at this point. There's, like, you know, that big macro element with all the Molson and Labatt and blah blah blah, and that comes with so many things. But there's also,
it's always right beside the toilets. I think that's always pretty funny.
Yeah. And then there's also, like, a really awesome dynamic, you know, craft section, which they really try and foster and build. So, I don't know. T-Fob's, like, just, it's a big festival. There's so many other festivals now, and if you want to be part of it, you're part of it. As a craft brewer, if you don't want to be part of it, you just don't do it, and it doesn't really matter. You do what you want.
Well, frankly, I think T-Fob, I always can, you, the word shit show always comes to mind with me, but mainly just in terms of, like, the enormous nature of it. No, you're right. I mean, just the encouragement of booth babes, the encouragement, well, not necessarily active encouragement of it, but it's definitely the dude bro demographic, and it is what it is on that, I guess, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I usually get offered free passes every year, and I stopped going because I'm going to get in a fist fight there. because there's the dude bros just drive me insane. And I really will, and I can't get arrested at this point in my life. last time I had like guys running up and jumping on me, ah, oh, we love you. I'm like, I don't love your type of person. Get away from me. You know?
Yeah,
I think it was Grey Lakes when I was working there maybe 3-4 years ago, and you know, they all come over to the booth and go, shut down, we're done, take off the tap handles, whatever, and guys would come up and just literally just bang their fists and go barbaric on me and be like, no, I need beer, and it's a crazy thing. Like it is that shit show element, which very much isn't aligned with the craft industry values, I think, you know.
Yeah, yeah, I just feel sorry for the security guards that work that place. So,
oh yeah.
Every time I've been there, and I haven't gone in a while because I refuse to. Every time I've gone, security have always sort of escorted someone out who's just covered in blood. It's weird.
Man.
But anyways, moving on.
Anyway,
going back to the topic. Yeah.
So. Marketing in Ontario, marketing around the world, you do see a lot of beers that are marketed either as Lee said, as a chick beer, or vice versa. You see them marketed with scantily clad ladies on them. What do you think is going on with the marketing aspects? What do you think has to change? I know even for you yourself, Robin, you had a conversation with one of the new brewers that is.
Oh, yeah.
Opening here in Ontario.
Yeah. So, I guess just in terms of the marketing and all that stuff, this is one of those things where I recall hearing on another, on a podcast, I think, somewhere, where they were saying that this was mainly a big beer problem. This was something that the big guys did, you know, where, you know, commercials with, you know, scantily clad women and all that stuff. But frankly, I keep thinking that a lot of people's minds go to that, but that's almost like late 90s big beer marketing where with the scantily clad women. I know it still happens, but I mean, everyone seems to go back to that time. And I'd actually argue that for the craft industry, and I'm not saying specifically Ontario, I'm saying pretty much internationally, I'd say it's worse in the craft industry because there's more tendency to sort of create sort of more off-color jokes into the names and all that stuff. And yeah, in terms of the brewery that I mentioned, or that I was talking to, I forget the name of it offhand, but it was essentially like this really tacky.
I still know the name.
Yeah, like this tacky sort of like truck decal. You know, just this a woman silhouette. You know, like the curvy woman silhouette, and tacky as hell. Tacky, dumb. But then you go into the sort of the more offensive stuff where like, you know, trashy blonde ale, I think, out of Texas. I think there was one beer that was like an acronym, but it was also known as Mouth Raper IPA. You want to go into ads. Actually, one that I've often disliked in Toronto's beer market, a blonde ale so beautiful, it's good even with the lights off or something like that. So, I mean, it's really fucking shitty. I'm sorry I keep swearing about that, but yeah, really, really bad.
Robin,
yeah,
you're with me and Lee, and usually I'm Irish and he's from Nova Scotia.
Okay.
Not swearing anyways, you're okay.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, we're being incredibly well-behaved right now, just so you know.
You know, it's funny, my the women's group that I co-run out here, we had a games night last month, and one of the games we played that I set up was misogyny beer names. And it was true, false, is this actually a beer name or not? And what surprised me when I was trying to make up names is how hard it was to make up a name. You Google it, no, that beer existed. And it shocked me how many horrible names there really were out there and how many are still present, because I feel like in my circle of beer, because you kind of get trapped in your circle, I don't see much of it, so you think, oh, it's getting better, I'm not really in craft anymore. But I was surprised the number, and then there's beers that I love, and I'm not going to name any names outside of the run of the U.S., but beers I love that I cringe when I look at what they're called, because in essence it goes against everything I believe. It's a good beer, but terrible. So, yeah, they're definitely out there.
Well, I mean, I think one of the problems is everybody thinks it's a big beer problem because you always see the commercials, or anytime you go to a bar that's selling, say, when Coors Light Iced Tea came out, you'd go to the bar that's promoting it, and it's all girls in just bikinis walking around handing it out. So they always think that it's a big beer problem because of that. But then you sit back and you think about things. Like, I mean, I love Nickel Brook's Naughty Neighbor, but look at the can art for that. At first, it was just, you know, a woman with the American, like, doing the Uncle Sam in the woman outfit. Okay, sure. And then he did the fishnet stockings, you know, up in the air and all that. Like,
have a Red Racer.
Red Racer IPA, yeah. Well, all the Red Racer beers, because it's all the exact same front piece.
Well, actually, it's funny that you mentioned Naughty Neighbor, because if I recall, a friend of mine actually complained to Nickel Brook about that, and Nickel Brook issued like a response saying that, I forget the exact wording, but it was essentially that, oh no, this woman's empowered and she enjoys it, which is ridiculous because you can't, it's a fictional character, you can't really, yeah, but yeah, so, yeah, it happens a lot.
I think you see that sexualization of women for sure on some beer labels, but on the flip side, you also have that dude culture, you know, where you see, so you've got your Naughty Neighbors and you've got your Old Flames and, you know, the other breweries that are doing things that are very explicit, but you've also got, like, the bro-y labels, the sports labels, you know, kind of that masculine thing that feels very, like, exclusive bro club. And it's still that understanding that, like, guys are our target audience and guys only. And as Robin said, you know, 50% of the population are dudes. There's still 50% of that are women. And I'm not saying women don't like sports, but I'm just saying that, you know, it is very, you can tell it's obviously kind of honed in for, like, a dude market.
I actually got to ask, sorry, I hate to interrupt. I was actually just wondering if you might know this, but do you know, like, what the sales are on this, that sort of dude bro market? Because I almost feel that with craft beer, we've sort of entered this area where essentially craft beer is a luxury good, and I think we can move beyond that. But I don't like how big is the dude bro market? I mean, I know that the yeah,
for craft, you mean?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I can tell you that whenever I get dude bro comments on any of my videos, they're always the Molson, Labatt, Sleeman, that type of video. Most people I know that would be in the dude bro category only drink Coors Light or Bud Light or anything like that because it's cheaper for them. They can get it anywhere they want. And college kids and all that, I mean, when I was in college, I had a lot of expendable income, so I could buy whatever I wanted, but a lot of kids will go out and just buy whatever the budget beer is that's around them. So, I mean, I don't think that you need the dude bro type of advertising to sell your beer.
A lot of that marketing, it seems to flare up around around the time of, like, playoffs and sport for different sports teams and stuff like that, too. So you'll see Coors or Molson come out with their special, you know, Molson especially will come out with, like, their special hockey editions of certain beers and stuff like that, where everything's, like, different can colors of different team colors and hockey pucks and all kinds of weird fucking promotional shit like toques and hockey pucks and crap like that, right? And you'll see the same thing in, like, with, like, Coors and Budweiser and stuff, baseball and football and stuff like that. Whenever those sports come around for their different seasons, all of a sudden you'll see that marketing just, like, skyrocket all of a sudden. You know, let's get all the sports fans in and buy all this shit. And I don't know if it necessarily spikes their sales or not. It'd be interesting to see if there's actually any, like, studies done on whether their sales actually spike during, like, sort of like playoff seasons and stuff like that when they do that marketing really heavy.
You'd almost think that something like that would have to be such a small demographic overall.
I don't know. For sports teams, I don't think so. I don't think that would be that small of a demographic.
There, but people that would actually pay attention to the marketing in that fashion?
Well, I don't know if they...
I feel like for them to do that, it has to make money. Like, they're not adding toques and golf balls and pucks if it's not effective. Like, Labatt and Molson have pretty intense understanding of how to boost their brand at certain periods in the LCBO.
I think the big question for that would come out, would they still have a spike in sales just because it's the playoffs, or do they have to put that puck in to make people buy it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, like, does the marketing have to be there?
Well, my thing in terms of craft marketing as well, I mean, like, is this actively trying to steal away that demographic from the cores and buds and or that, or is this just generally trying to go for that demographic?
It being something that would attract, say, this pack of, like, Labatt's got golf balls in it, or you could buy this pack of Budweiser with a t-shirt in it. Which one would you rather buy? Oh, golf balls is cooler than a t-shirt.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just kind of going for that. I mean, is it really more about the marketing? Like, who are they preaching to in that kind of demographic? Like, who wants the free shit?
Well, can you actually go out and say, unless you're selling, like, Golden Horseshoe Ale with a puck in it or something, can you go out there and say, you know, here's our Cameron's Lager at $48 a 2-4. We put a t-shirt in it. Buy this instead of your $39 Canadian that you buy all the time. Yeah, I don't think they could actually get the dude bros to pay that extra $10.
No, and I mean, their marketing is specifically designed for those different promotions. It's designed within the demographic they're going for. Like, yeah, if you put
the blonde centerfold on the bottle of Cameron's Lager, like you have on the bottle of Milwaukee Ice or something like that, will he be more interested in buying it then?
I think price is the ultimate
for them.
Yeah.
In these promotions, it seems like it's something the sports teams the big breweries just always do. Like, it's a traditional thing at this point, whether it makes them that much more money at all or not. I think it's just they get a good licensing deal or whatever with whatever sports team for that year, or just the whole organization as a whole, and it's like, yeah, we'll get some cheap pucks and shirts from China and throw them in our shit. I mean, it's only going to cost us like 25 cents on the dollar anyway, you know, why not?
Well, I'm going to jump into some carved out pumpkin from Wellington, and I'm going to say to the ladies here, how about you, how have you felt you've been received in the industry yourselves? I know Robin's kind of touched on it. Has things gotten better in the time you've been in the industry? Because I know as each year comes by, it seems to at least be a little more accepted for females to be in the industry. And I actually, lastly as well on this, what do you feel about the thought process of a lot of men that, you know, this is a man's only industry, which kind of makes me laugh since women were historically the brewers in days gone by?
Well, I feel like I was listening to the question, I lost the first bit, but you were asking, right, how we feel that we're responded to in the industry and if things have changed. You know, every time I think things have, it's hard because I've never felt things were drastically terrible, but there's always been some issues there. But then every time I feel like we're kind of working past those issues and going into a new place where women are completely on par with men or it's a 50-50 thing, something happens that kind of takes me by surprise and reminds me that it is still a boys' club and there is still a lot of work to be done. A personal example, when I was at the conference recently, the Ontario Craft Beer Conference, amazing time, great people, and I had a guy who's opening a brewery kind of suddenly come over and start flash interviewing me for a brewer position, which was interesting because I hadn't expressed any interest in leaving my brewery and I'm quite happy where I am. So I was shocked, but, you know, I'm talking to him and I'm answering his questions. And then he notices my wedding ring and quits asking me questions and finishes up with, oh, he was just, you know, trying to meet me, and kind of walks off. And it was a huge reminder that you're not necessarily taken as seriously as the men. And there's things like that happen once in a while that remind you that you're not taken as seriously. when I'm at the counter, and usually, like I said, brewers are great, but when I'm at work and somebody comes in from another brewery and shakes the hands of all the guys and assumes I'm just the counter girl and skates right past me. So there are still definite reactions and definite responses that remind you that you're not yet. It's not completely, it's not equal, and there's still a lot of change that needs to be had.
I'll just cut in there, Chad. Beerzerker wants an invite if you want to throw one at him.
I don't invite on these unless they're here right away.
All right.
He can wait till we're offline.
It's funny. Everyone is like, "Oh, can I come in now?" It's like you only put a message like days beforehand that if you want to come in, you have to have questions and you want to join the panel. Now everyone wants to join the bloody panel.
Alrighty, so anyone else? Erica? Robin?
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe Toronto landscape's slightly different. I think I feel it's pretty strong in Toronto right now, whether it's Siobhan, who's head brewing over at Burdock, you know,
she
Bridget,
makes some great
really,
beer over there.
Oh, she's incredible. Yeah, great brewer. You know, Bridget's doing her thing. She's a Bose rep. Mary Beth is rocking it at Bose. You know, the list goes on and on. There's a lot of women in Toronto, and I think the scene's pretty stable. It doesn't feel like more than regular life being a woman in the world. It kind of feels like here and there I definitely get some weird stuff. Maybe I'm just used to it because I work with all dudes, and it's just like now a custom and part of my life. And I don't know, but I mean, you definitely get weird stuff that happens sometimes with bar owners. And sometimes with LCBO employees and sometimes with beer store employees especially, you know, you definitely get that. You get that kind of dumb girl thing sometimes, but it's all about just being tough and you know, just pushing through and kind of putting them in their place, I guess, if that makes any sense, and just being kind of badass and not letting them walk all over you. So I feel like Erin and I probably experience it on a daily basis, and we're probably both just like, fuck it, you know? It sucks. I'm not trying to, it sucks, but it's just like it's a reality that you have to just kind of deal with here and there.
It's a reality, but it's a reality you'd like to see changed. I mean, yeah. Eventually you'd like to see where it is 50-50 footing, and, you know, you're not constantly having to fight prove that you are on equal footing, or that you have to prove yourself to show that you're as good as, you know, the boys next to you.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, you do. Like, I mean, honestly, I had to actually sit down and think, because as much as, you know, feminism and all this thing has always kind of been my soapbox, you do get used to it, and you do start kind of blocking it out, and you're like, oh, I don't think anything's really happening anymore, and then you stop and think, and you're like, oh, yeah, it is, every day. And it would be nice to see that kind of completely go away.
Yeah, and yeah, I guess from my point of view as well, I mean, I'm very much on par with Erin there, where, I mean, there's a lot of times where it's great, it's fantastic, and then just every once in a while something will come up and you'll be like, yep, we still have a long way to go, we still need to address this. I've heard people from, well, dudes from within the industry as well as out, make some of the most horrendous jokes, say some of the most horrendous things. I think, you know, a big part of that is just sort of the culture they're in. If you're a brewery, say, or a group of guys where essentially, like, you all have just sort of the similar sense of humor and you just think you're being funny and you think that everyone else will think that's funny because your group of guys thinks that funny, then they're trying to do that. I mean, we're definitely looking a lot... I definitely see a lot more of the motivation behind some of this shitty stuff. And, you know, I've realized that, like, you know, there's no... they're not actively making the decision to oppress or anything like that. I get that a lot of this is a very conditioned thing. But with that, it's very important that in those instances that, yeah, you stand your ground, you say, hey, that was a really shitty thing, here's why. Unfortunately, the initial reaction is always, you know, 9 times out of 10 is going to be, you know, oh, you're just being too sensitive, you know, which I think a lot of us have heard. But you'll actually hear some guys that just had absolutely no clue. And they'll be schooled on it. Do I think it's better than it was a couple of days ago? Yes and no. I mean, it's always just sort of like, for every like five great examples, there's one horrible example. It's been like that for a while. A lot more needs to change, I think, in terms of acceptance in the acceptance of women. Again, it's not an active thing, but I lost my train of thought, I'm afraid. I think one of the big things that needs to be done in terms of acceptance, and I don't mean this just in terms of women, but also, while we're saying it, people of color, LGBT folks, there seems to be this sort of mentality that silence means acceptance, and I disagree with that. At that stage, it needs to be sort of be more open in terms of acceptance.
Alrighty. I guess a question would come out. Is it sometimes I don't even know how to say that without sounding stupid myself. I know that a lot of people say things that they really shouldn't, and like you said, it is a lot of times a response that has been trained into them. Do you find that sometimes it's hard to differentiate the people that are saying something stupid that are meaning it to be stupid versus the people that actually have malice?
Does it matter?
Yeah, exactly. What Erin said, it doesn't matter.
I mean, because I guess to say that, you know, malice, in essence, you would think that's worse, but malice by ignorance is still... It is still a problem.
Yeah, and knowing the motivation behind it, I mean, doesn't make the thing less shitty. It's just something that, you know, like, you know where it comes from now, but you still need to address it. It still needs to be talked about.
Yeah, I mean, even if you're using humor and you think you're being cute and funny, it's still coming from the same core.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when people, you know, laugh when they see me on the equipment or, you know, assume that there's no way I could deal with that equipment because I'm a girl. I know they don't mean harm. I know it just comes from them not thinking, but it still sucks that the respect is not the same for that my male counterparts would get. And none of these people are being purposely malicious, if that makes sense.
Yep. We do have two different questions here, Chad. I noticed one on the actual
Marvin's
Google page. Yeah, Marvin's on the Google page.
Marvin would like you ladies to give him a recommendation for beers to try when he comes to the U.S. He's from Jamaica. All he drinks is Red Stripe.
When he comes to the U.S. or when he comes to Canada?
He's going to the U.S.
Keep in mind he drinks Red Stripe, so if you want to give him like macro recommendations that are probably more widely available, that'd probably be acceptable as well, I think.
My favorite beers are not going to work for him.
Yeah, he didn't tell us where in the U.S. he's going either, so I don't know what type of distribution he's looking at.
Yeah. I'd just say Marvin, find a bottle shop.
Take a chance, Marvin. Take a chance.
I would say 6 Points the Crisp. It's a German Pilsner. It is just... I only had one when I was in Chicago, and I still have dreams about it.
And see, Robin's the greatest one to answer these questions because I would have given him stuff he would have hated.
You should try Bo's Lug Tread because they're in New York State now.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I think they're in Ohio as well.
Yeah.
So if those are the two states, one of the two states you're going to, Marvin, outside of the 50,
assume you're going to New York, Marvin.
Yeah. And we had another one from the Beer Zerker on Facebook. He says, He just wanted to ask, and he's in Alberta, one of the Prairie provinces.
Yes, he's in Alberta.
Yeah, so he said he just wanted to ask, what is the best way to get into the industry, no matter what sex you are? It seems impossible out here, I guess, for women to get into it, or I guess he's even saying for men to get into it, apparently.
Yeah, remember, he was talking at one point about starting his own brewery until he found out how much it was going to cost.
That seems to be a thread. I would say I probably get at least a resume a day from somebody, and the best way that a lot of people enter the industry is just show up, just start volunteering, just volunteer. Like, I know it sucks, and I know, you know, people have to make money, that's a thing, but like, even if you can just show up and work events, or if you can just show up and shovel out spent grain after a mat, like, mash out with the brewers, or learn how to keg off a tank of beer, or wash kegs, or clean floors. I mean, the best resumes are ones that aren't, like, really naive and are like, I want to be a brewer, but I don't really have much experience. Can you help? The best are like, hey, like, I'm willing to scrub floors and, like, learn the hard way, and all my brewers have done that. Like, John and Mike and Sam, they're all guys that are willing to pick up a broom and squeegee this, and it sucks, Erin, you know, like, it's hard. It's not sexy.
It's, you burn yourself.
Yeah, it's hot, and it's sweaty, and you work in a factory, and it's dangerous, and it's fun, but, like, it's definitely, it's not that glamorous job that people think, right?
So I would argue with you that me inside a fermenter is pretty damn sexy.
Oh, that's an interesting visual, Chad.
No, you don't want that visual. I apologize right off the bat for that one.
I hope clothed.
Yeah, no breweries let me do a beer naked beer review in their fermenters yet.
Yeah, that's probably not something you would want to bet on.
Not unless they want to spike it with any kind of yeast, I guess.
Oh my gosh. But yeah, just showing up and being willing to hustle, and most craft breweries are small businesses.
You know what? A lot of the guys that I know have just made friends with brewers, just made friends with them, and, you know, and going in all the time, and like she said, volunteering. You have an hour. You, hey, do you need anything done? You might not get paid. You're not giving your whole day, but they'll give you a beer or two.
I mean,
Devin. Yeah. Devin, who used to be Colgate here on the Beer Review, is now a brewer at Innocente. Like, and that's the way he went in. He did the beerumentary segment with me, and then he kept meeting Steve all the time and doing stupid little odd jobs around the brewery, and now he's brewing.
Cool. Connections. This industry is all about connections. It is a tiny little industry. It's, you know, almost everybody fast. So you get out there, get involved, meet people, and that's one of your best ways to get into the industry.
That's the way I'd want to see it done, right? I mean, I'd rather buy beer from someone who's worked their way up and, you know, they were scrubbing the floors and stuff and still do it to this day, even though they might own a brewery at this point, right? As opposed to some person who just comes in with a couple million dollars and, oh, I'm a brewer now. I got a brewery. No, fuck you. You're an idiot.
Yeah, agreed with all points. I mean, like, start from the bottom, work at other breweries, volunteer, do your, you know, earn your medal, or earn your stripes, I should say. Keep working as much as possible. All the connections you make, too. I mean, these are people that are going to help you down the line. You definitely need that. I'd also say, depending on what side you want to look at, but you're starting a brewery or going anywhere in the industry, take an honest look at yourself and be honest about what you're good at and what your faults are.
I think, too, there's also an element of social media that comes to play where, you know, I'll give the example of Marissa, a friend of mine over out in Ottawa. She's now marketing and events coordinator at Side Launch.
Side Launch now?
Yeah.
Wasn't she just at? I might be thinking of a different Marissa. It's just not a very. Okay, continue. Sorry.
She was the beer gypsy. I don't know.
Yes, she was at Beyond the Pale for a while.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah.
No, she did some stuff for Beyond the Pale. She was
Clocked.
That's why I was like, Clocked really, at Side Launch already? Because yeah, the last time I talked to her, she was Side Launch, Beyond the Pale.
She was at Flying Monkeys. Yeah, she's done some stuff, but I think yeah, just she's found a good fit with Side Launch, and you know, and having a really strong social media presence. So, you know, showing up to events, and Robin, you're great with this too, right? Like, just really being active on it and really showing that you're like a leading voice in beer things, and you know, people pay attention to that and people respect that, and that obviously goes a long way if you keep on top of it, I think, too.
Now, do you feel that the college is a great aspect for female brewers? Because a lot of times a female going into a brewery wouldn't get hired for a bottling line or scrubbing or this and that. But now they're going into the college, and the college every year is getting more and more female applicants. And they're able to come out of the college right away and go into jobs that kind of circumvent and surpass just the average bottling line laborer job, which, again, was mostly just your average, like, 20-year-old man.
I don't know if the college helps. It has the same kind of footwork for females as men, regardless, when it comes to getting in.
Yeah, I still think there's only like one or two females in every program too. Like, it's not amazing. And I think at the end of the day, there's nothing wrong with anybody graduating Niagara to start at the bottling line.
You're right on that. It's just a lot of them that do graduate Niagara don't feel they should start at the bottling line.
Well, that's just an issue of academia, I think, in general. Like, having that kind of grandiose ego on you that thinks you can, like, be a superstar brewer. Like, you know, I think there is... Niagara's great, and Niagara has trained a lot of people, and we're seeing some pretty talented people that have left the program. But just like anything, you know, you still have to work. You still have to hustle, and you still have to prove yourself whether or not you go to Niagara. Like, Erin, you didn't go to Niagara, right? No.
No, I'm doing Siebel right now.
Oh, cool. But yeah, so obviously training's amazing and education's great, and it's really cool if you get in. It's very hard to get into these programs, so if you get in, amazing. But when you graduate, you know, you need to still be ready to learn all the kind of grunt work that goes into brewing, you know. I think the first year graduating program, yeah, everybody got brewing jobs right off the bat because it was like, woo, all these like brewer people. And now it's kind of like it's not as easy.
There's only so many brewing positions out there, especially head brewing positions. There's not enough in this area for all the grads. So
yeah,
I think if you want to become a brewer, there's always a bit of floor scrubbing before you get up there. Well, almost always.
Well, I think for brewing positions, it's a lot like teaching and other such jobs. There are a lot of jobs out there. You just have to move to somewhere you don't want to be.
Yeah.
I mean, how many breweries are opening on, like, Manitoulin Island and up in, like, just, like, nowhere areas are always opening breweries now. Baysview out in Erie, Ontario. There's one road into that town. One road. If that road floods, you're stuck there. Like, those type of places are where you have
well,
to
Well, even, open. You know, Van Cleek Hill.
Well, Van Cleek Hill's at least, you know, somewhat near Ottawa, right on the Quebec border. Oh, just because there's more cows than people doesn't mean anything.
You know what, though? I got to say, Northern Ontario is really... I'm going to be keeping an eye on Northern Ontario for the next 5 years because I think it's just going to be booming up there. It's... I mean, already you've got, like, New Ontario Brewing in North Bay. Manitoulin Island, it does have a brewery.
It has, like, three of them.
Yeah. You know, Timmins, yeah, they're really popping up there, and it's really going well.
Yeah, and I mean, where was I even going to go there? Now that I've been drinking, my mind doesn't work as well. It's all these concussions I've had.
See, that's why you got to have the water, yeah.
Oh, I still have like 500 cases of water, don't you worry. I'm good.
Are you preparing for the apocalypse?
I am prepared. Beer festivals.
Nobody drinks water. You have an excess of water.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody keeps going for the like nut brown instead of the water.
Oh, and while we're while I was naming Northern Ontario Brewing as well, Sleeping Giant.
I didn't remember where Sleeping Giant was at.
Thunder Bay. outspoken brewery in Sault Ste. Marie. I mean, it's there's a lot, and they're just starting to grow. It's great.
Now, I know that this isn't as much a women in brewing topic, but just because you're here, let's get your take on this. Ontario's distribution. I mean, that's I think the one thing the U.S. has over us, and I mean, they always say that they make better beer than us, but I found a lot of beer that's equal or superior to a lot of American super beers. They do have, in the long run, the more amazing beer than us, but I think the biggest thing they have over us is distribution, where you can get a beer from Florida in New York State and all that. Here in Ontario, you have a hard fucking time getting a beer from Ontario in Ontario. I mean, I've never had anything from Sleeping Giant. I've never had anything from Manitoulin Island. I've never had anything from Thunder Bay. The list can go on, and unless I have little spies in different areas, I'm not getting those beers.
Well, actually, I should say firstly, too, the reason why you're not getting any Sleeping Giant is because Sleeping Giant doesn't want you to get it. They haven't left Thunder Bay because they think that they're doing well enough there for now. And that's the case of a lot of the breweries up in Northern Ontario, where essentially they're doing really well in their communities, but they don't feel that they need to make that shift to earn, I guess, the big city approval, you know? So.
Yeah. I think that's kind of cool. I think that there is this really interesting trend of like regional breweries. I think when everybody started, they felt they had to just do everything and spread across the province. And now, especially with the LCBO, the LCBO has gotten a lot better with allowing. They were always concerned about store listings and quantity, and now they're concerned about. They just give a shit about whether you're selling enough volume at every store that you choose to have your beer in. Oh, nice, Chad. So yeah, and the LCBO is getting really, 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 really tough. You know, every brewery you've talked to has, you know, that has tried to put an LCBO beer on the shelf has been rejected at least once. Like, it's just getting really intense. So you might never see Sleeping Giant because they might just be like, screw it, I don't even want to be in the LCBO. I just want to sell directly, regionally in my area. And I mean, the Ontario craft brewers kind of want that. The John Hay, the president, he said, he's like, I think our goal is to have a brewery in every community in Ontario, and that's kind of cool. And it's cool to keep just like regional specialties.
Now the big thing with that idea is that I think it would keep the bubble from ever popping. I mean, we keep growing, and if you're just for your region, just for your few neighborhoods, you don't really have a problem of ever oversaturating, but yeah, like.
I would actually just argue that in Ontario, we don't have to worry about a bubble or oversaturation for some time. I think we're not at U.S. levels on that. We're not at sort of chaotic levels there. I think we're good. But yeah, okay, sorry, continue.
No, well, you are correct, and I was going to go there, but I mean. When you figure it, we have, what is it now? Well, you would know, you're doing the book. Is it just over 200 now operating?
I think in total we kept it around, I think, 186, was it? So, yeah, nearly 200, yeah.
Yeah, so, but the majority of those are in certain areas. I mean, you have a lot in Ottawa, you have a lot in Toronto, you have a whole bunch happening here in the Golden Horseshoe. Like, you have areas that have huge numbers, and the great thing about Ontario is it is a huge population base spread over a huge landmass, so, I mean, we still have a lot of regional breweries that can open up, because there are places that still don't have anything.
You think it would be nice if there was, not necessarily LCBO-type markets, or markets that are really hard and competitive to get into, but something more accessible to smaller breweries to be able to put a little bit of stock across, to be able to showcase your wares maybe in more areas than just where you are.
It doesn't really have some of the same OCB hurdles. Was allowed to open up their own beer store, like the beer store.
Yeah.
That would have been amazing. Have an OCB beer store everywhere that just sold beers from the OCB, but then you have the NATO problem and all that, but whatever. Whatever, I'm drinking.
Well, what about all the 50% of new breweries that aren't even becoming a part of the OCB? That's a whole other conversation.
Yeah. But I mean, just the fact that you can have a government entity that says only government stores can exist, but grocery stores can now sell, and we can have a foreign-owned store that sells, but we can't have a Ontario-only market that sells anything, just kind of bothers me. And it would help the distribution a lot. I mean, I would be able to get beers from places I can't get.
It's an anti-small business. It's anti-small business. I don't like it. I really don't. I mean, it just shows how much collusion there is between the big guys and different people in government. Whenever you see something like that comes down. Oh no, you got to take baby steps. No bullshit. You don't have to take baby steps. You just have to stop, you know, having your pockets lined by Molson and Labatt and those people.
You'd think it would help them too, because they'd make more tax money in the long run.
They don't care.
You're taxing the business. You're taxing the employees of the business. You're taxing the purchases from the business.
Yeah, but the tax.
Lots more tax money.
But the tax money supposedly goes out and helps the people to some degree. These people are getting their pockets lined by big breweries. They don't give a fuck about the rest of the people. They care about their own bank accounts. Mm-hmm.
True. Yeah, Lee, Nick, have anything to add before we go on? Lee, what was your other question? Has it been touched?
Well, yeah, it has been touched. I was going to ask sort of in general if over time have the ladies here found that being accepted into the industry has been more acceptable? Has it been easier to make their way in the industry? And I think it's been pretty much well covered throughout the entire chat. I think they brought it up pretty well. So it's all been articulated. To my satisfaction, anyway.
So. Nicholas?
Why are you even here, Nick? What are you doing?
I don't know why I'm here.
I was expecting
to get here this early.
I guess for you ladies, especially anyone that's traveled, I mean, you did your road trip with your brother Erica and all that. Do you think the Ontario beer market is more accepting than some of the other markets across Canada or across the U.S.? Because there are a lot of stories that come out of blatant sexism.
More accepting, what do you mean? Like for women or for the LCBO?
Yeah, more open to women brewers, women in the industry.
Mm-hmm. I think the blatant sexism happens here too. I think it happens across the board.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I don't think you'll ever get rid of it. I'm just saying, does it seem to be less here or equal, more?
Does it matter?
Not really.
I've never really traveled. It would be interesting to travel and see. I have no point of reference.
Yeah. I mean, I think in America, often things are just bigger and more intense and more pronounced in general with everything. So, I know. Like, we went to a brew pub by accident called the Dirty Blonde, and it was pretty ridiculous. And it was just opening, too. So it wasn't like it'd been around for 20 years, and it was this, like, established crazy place, and all the girls had like little tube tops on and were beautiful and 90 pounds and, you know, crazy tight pants, and they all wore the same uniform, and it was crazy. And like you wouldn't see that. I mean you've got things like Mascot Brewing and stuff like that in downtown Toronto that are started to open up in like the financial district with a lot of money, and so that obviously breeds like a certain level of gendered kind of service. But this was pretty intense, and there was like a lady in a bikini with like a moving leg on the wall, and it was weird. I don't know. I mean, the beer was amazing. It wasn't, it was great, great beer, but it was still funny that like a brew pub in downtown Chicago still felt the need to like be super sexualized and have a bunch of really hot kind of ditzy girls serving the males in the financial district of Chicago craft beer.
Well, and on that level too, I mean, I guess in terms of the comparison as well, I mean, aside from it being really unfair to compare a single province to an entire country, I think you know, like the U.S. is very varied, and Ontario is very varied. Very varied. Anyways, you're going to have a lot of problems anywhere in that situation. I mean, especially in Ontario as well. I mean, just in terms of even having that discussion and being a brewery that feels this need to sort of go with this sexualized marketing. I mean, you know, being at a conference and overhearing some folks from a fairly respectable brewery either joke or talk about, I wasn't 100% sure on it, but just about how they need, you know, sexy women, you know, to help them advertise, you know, that they should have had some booth babes at this thing. So,
yeah. It happens. It's
it happens. Okay. Yeah, it happens. It's really shitty, and, you know, but that said, I would definitely like that to change.
It's funny, too, because there's definitely, like, in terms of, that has never been part of my Black Oak existence, like, that is, there's so many amazing breweries that have, like, really awesome feminist male allies that work there, so, you know, I 100% agree with you, Robin, like, it does happen in the industry, and we all know those names in the industry that we don't need to say, but for them, you know, that's where, as a woman, you know, you also find your great kick-ass brewery with awesome dudes that think you're the shit and think that you're smart and just honor your intelligence and your work ethic, and really there's not a lot of, like, it's just, it's, there is a sense of, like, we're all just a team.
Yeah. 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 I mean, I understand exactly what you're saying with it being varied. I mean, I'm sure Toronto is different than a lot of places, and you probably would think that a lot of the smaller towns are going to be worse, but I've been in a lot of smaller towns that are more accepting than even some bigger cities.
Mm. Probably also in a lot of the bigger cities, they're actually directly competing with macro companies in the market a lot more, too, so you might see that stuff a lot more. Sort of counter-marketing, well, not counter-marketing, comparative marketing, I guess. Well, they're using hot chicks in our ads. We should use hot chicks in our ads as well.
Here's a beer with a sexualized woman on it. Yeah!
Wait, what beer was that?
It's Dia de Ciel, aphrodisiac.
That's my, like, favorite stout.
Oh,
I have so many favorite stouts. I know, I love that beer.
I wish you could send beer on Google Hangout.
Yeah, that would be nice.
I just wish they'd distribute their beer a bit more widely, that's all.
Well, you just have to go to New York State and you can get any beer you want.
Yeah, I should go. I should get a fucking passport and go to New York. Then I can get all Canadian beer I want.
We've been getting a ton of Quebec beer here in New Brunswick lately, but we haven't gotten that anything from Dweebs, and that's what I want.
Oh, it's so Either good.
A fresh motel, or... Damn it.
Well, who's messaging me now? I'm hearing beeping.
Probably Gee.
Well, here we have a comment from Rideflat43 saying he's enjoying these knowledgeable, feisty woman's insights. So there you go.
Woman's, eh?
Woman's.
I also have a comment here that said earlier tonight that Lee has not sworn for 50 minutes, which is a record.
And I was trying to be...
Don't say that there's a fucking...
No, I was trying to be semi-professional here.
Whatever.
I got invited to the chat, so I didn't want to ruin it, so there you go.
Basement Beer Reviews asks a question. Would you rather have, A, the beer store model begin to introduce more craft beers, C, LCB Gold continue as is, and the beer store go away, or C, have both the LCBO and beer store go? That might be longer, because I'm in my email, so let's just click here and see what happens. You might give us a D option.
Can we invent an option?
Oh, I can't. Yeah, invent an option because I can't even read it because he's commenting and YouTube tells me comments don't exist.
Oh, my. I think... the one thing I saw at the OCB conference is... I mean, I'm not a big supporter of the beer store model, but they are at least trying to be more inclusive. They're making it easier. The LCBO, they've done a lot lately, too. I wouldn't want to see them go away. I would like to see the rise of other avenues, too. It's not so much I want to see them disappear as much as I'd like to see more options, better options, more accessibility.
I agree. And I think I also can't really comment too much because the beer store and the LCBO are major major channels that we deal with Black Oak, so I'm just going to kind of stay mute on that. But I do think that there's more that can be done for sure in addition to what's currently happening.
I would like to see the LCBO stay. I would like to see the beer store stay. I would like to see grocery stores rise. I would like to see convenience stores rise and start to sell beer as well. I would like to see eye-bleeding chaos in terms of selling beer, because in that sense, then we'll reach this. We'll reach a point where we actually start to feel almost an oversaturation, and then in that case, the quality of beer, the cream will rise. But yeah, and just in terms of selling, I'd love something more on par with America.
Great answer. That's the
The best part of that answer is eye bleeding chaos. Exactly.
Yeah. No, just when your eyes are bleeding and you can do nothing but laugh in the face of all that's the variety that's there.
Yeah, it should be more choice for consumers is the ideal way to go.
No, that's definitely for sure.
Let them vote with their dollars.
Did you try this beer yet, Lee?
What beer is it?
The Black Oak Vintage Ale.
Yeah, I have. Should I say what I thought of it here?
Yeah, make Erica cry.
I don't know if I'll make her cry, but I wasn't... I'll just say I probably should have sat on it for a year before I tried it. Let's just put it that way. Because I found it was a little too spice-heavy. And I think maybe if after a year, I don't know what spices were in it. Were there cloves in it? Zero spices, really? Okay, interesting. Because it tastes
all East water hops, baby.
Oh, okay. Because I got this really weird spicy kick, so it must have been from the hops. And I felt like after a year, it probably would have died down, and the rest of the beer would have come up with it. Mm-hmm. But that's just my personal opinion on it.
Is it just out of the brewery?
Yeah, we actually shipped it to Alberta for the advent calendar.
Oh.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was just like a low... We hardly have... We're sold out now at the brewery, but we shipped them all out.
And I shared one of the bottles you sent me to Lee there. So
I'm glad you got my special pack I sent you, Chad.
I almost didn't. I found it underneath all the advertising material.
Oh, my gosh.
I will say I liked it. I gave it a positive mark. I'm just saying that I probably should have sat on it for a year before I reviewed it.
That's fair.
Irish Greg, not Toronto Greg, which is the only Greg whose comments we will read tonight, says hi to all of you and says we definitely need more women like you that love beer and love the industry in the industry.
Thanks, Greg.
Hi, Greg. Thanks.
Hi, Greg.
Yeah, no, go to bed, Greg. It's late.
It's like 3 a.m. there. Get to sleep.
Yeah.
Anything any of you ladies want to touch on before we wrap up? How's the book going?
The book is going. we'll be submitting the manuscript end of next week.
Just so you know, this is the first and only book I'll probably ever pre-order.
Awesome, thank you.
It's not like I can read anyway, so I hope there's a lot of pictures.
There is.
That's what to say. First and only you'll ever pre-order. Yeah, first and only you'll ever pre-order. Second only book he's ever read in his life. It'll be great.
Yeah, no, there'll be plenty of pictures. We definitely have a color insert of like 20 pictures, a few more black and white ones in terms of that as well. And what the hell? Audiobook by Will Wheaton. You know, he's very dynamic.
I was trying so badly to sell him on the Niagara Falls beer, the one I throw in Ridgeway. I was trying to sell him on it in May because I subscribed to him and all that, and we chatted back and forth for a while about it. I'm like, you should come. He goes, you're a crazy stalker. I'm not. You really should come.
But yeah, two audiobooks, one by Will Wheaton and the other by Christopher Walken.
That would be good.
The Christopher Walken one is going to be like 6 hours longer than the Will Wheaton one.
It's looking like it's going to be about 8 hours longer, and he really likes talking about Stack. I don't know why.
What?
I don't know.
Do William faster, and then you'll be good.
If you have but nobody owns tapes anymore, right?
No, it's all CDs now.
Yeah, or MP3s. If you have an abridged version of A Lot of Swear Words, you can get Samuel L. Jackson to read your book, or just like those children's book they had a bunch of different celebrities read.
Go the fuck to sleep.
Go to fuck to sleep. Yeah, there you go. Get Werner Herzog to read your book.
Actually, Greg from Toronto just Facebooked me with, why wouldn't you read my questions, Chad? I had so many questions. A few of them were about beer. And right there is why we wouldn't read your questions.
Yeah.
Great.
Greg's in the cage tonight.
After we talked about the book, anything Erin or Erica would like to chat about before I jump this offline? None of you are kicked off when we go offline, but I know that some people have to sleep and possibly cry about something they're doing.
Aw, dude.
Yeah, I wasn't talking about Robin. I was talking about Nick.
Hey, I have this case of spilled beer.
What? Oh, that's weird.
No.
I did not expect that from Nick. I'm sorry.
Oh, we're still online. Sorry. I
appreciate this opportunity to come and talk about this. I think it's important to address it and chat with it. And it's one of those things you don't ever talk about, especially in this industry. You kind of stay quiet, but it's important to kind of shine a light on it.
I super appreciate you ladies coming in. I'm trying to do an international version as well, but I can only find ladies in Europe, really, and that's going through another beer reviewer in Europe who's also a beer server, and she was able to find me some people in Europe. I can't actually really collect anybody in the U.S. that really wants to come on and do this, so our next episode will probably be European-centric, and I know nothing about their beer industry at all.
Cool. So that should be much more enlightening as far as just, different cultures go. That would be quite interesting, I think.
Yeah.
Because you don't really hear about the craft beer scene over there at all. Really.
Mm-hmm. Erica, anything you would like to add? Society of Beer Drinking Women?
No, not really. Thank you, though. This was a great opportunity. It was good to connect with Robin and Erin, and I appreciate it. I think we brought up some pretty interesting points, and we're having fun, and we're rocking it in the industry, but it is important to stop and bring light to the fact that it's not perfect and there is still, things that need to be addressed and need to be worked on.
Yeah, and it was really great to have a very frank discussion about this.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Chad, for organizing
it. Well, thank you guys for coming, and it was great to have you, and everybody watching, you'll be able to comment in a second, apparently. Bye.